I'm at Jacksonville Elementary School in Oregon, and I'm going to be talking to kindergarten up to third grade. Sixth grade.
That is sponsored by this.
Sponsored by the Southern Oregon Humane Society, and I'm looking forward to doing this.
Okay.
I'm at the Jacksonville Elementary School, and I'm going to talk to get grades from kindergarten to sixth grade, and I want everybody to know that this is sponsored by the Southern Oregon Humane Society, and I'm really looking forward to talking to the kids.
To do that, I was the first one they asked to do that, and I actually had to do a little interview as to their producers, but they wanted me to be more like psychically do it. And I don't like that word, psychic. I like the word, and I'm a communicator, that is, I want to take the spooky part off of it. Because you know what? It's my right brain. I happen to be very visually oriented, and I am very creative. I can paint really well. So if you're having trouble reading, writing, and doing the arithmetic, and you are really, really good at drawing and painting, and you are really, really good at fantasizing and daydreaming, do you know that you could grow up and be an animal communicator? Yeah, but I didn't know I could do that. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to turn the television on, and we're going to watch me working with three different animals. You'll see me and see a bunch of elephants, and then we'll see me working with a horse that has a jumping problem, and then you'll see me working with another horse that has problems with the way in which they want him to move. So we're going to turn the lights down, and I hope everybody can see the TV, and we'll turn it up as loud as we possibly can, and then I'm going to tell you exactly how I gave that information to those horses, and then I'll tell you how I do it, okay?
Three or four enormous crowd, and then they worked all day to take and separate the tongue from the skull. And once that was done, it was as if something was lifted throughout the whole earth.
It's theorized in the wild that elephants will have a brief period, and they'll even pick up bones of elephants that have died and carry them with them, just a chance to kind of recognize that they're not here anymore, pay their respects. I guess that's how we put it in human terms.
How do the elephants communicate with Samantha? She believes that animals transmit thought with pictures instead of words, and that she is interested in receiving those pictures.
It's almost like going back to being in kindergarten. You see the flashcards and a picture of the boat, and then the word of the boat. By the time you get into first or second grade, that word represents the visual impression.
And Samantha uses the same kind of word pictures to talk back to her clients, like these thoroughbred show horses in Del Mar, California. These horses are working professionals, and their owners have a big stake in their success.
She turned around and started telling me things about the horses. Only I had the ride to know about.
Toby the jumper. Great horse. I first met Toby because he was having some problems with jumping.
He was doing very well in one of them. And he'd go to show ring and my sport will rail. And it just felt to me that his concentration wasn't there.
Toby gave me visual impressions originally on how he was jumping. And that he didn't understand that this is really serious business. He was much more playful. As I talked about going over the jumps, that what he needed to do was just lift his legs up just a little bit higher, tuck them up close to his body, and then that his relationship with Mark was a business.
When Samantha was communicating with Toby and how he should be jumping on the fences, she would go ahead and run. Well, Toby now runs over certain fences. He doesn't run over every single fence, but every time he goes over a fence really well, and he runs, he's doing it in fairly good form. So I have to associate that with something that Samantha did. I think we're probably taking a whole year to what Samantha's been able to accomplish through the 2 month period of just communicating with him once.
Toby is just one of many success stories Samantha has had working with horses at this facility. But not everyone is convinced.
Well, I'm not really sure what you expect. I'm not very familiar with this stuff yet. I guess I gotta be open-minded.
It's only natural that many animal owners are skeptical before their first session. Diamond has recently become unruly, refusing to trot properly. After his owners went through the usual course of behavioral specialist, they decided to try something different.
Pretend that you're like Superman or Spider-Man. Raise your hand.
that you're Harry Potter. How many of you can pretend that you're Ariel? This is a little kid. I can tell you guys are really enthusiastic, and fantasizing is really an important aspect of your nature. It's a very important thing. So, what I do is I pretend I'm a horse, and I close my eyes, and I let myself see Toby jumping. That's where I start. And so as I can feel that I'm Toby jumping, and I quieted my mind, my emotions, my nerves, so that I can pick up information from Toby, and then I can give visions back to Toby. So all of a sudden, when I'm jumping, I can see that his front legs are kind of sloppy. And so what I did was I said to him, Toby, you have to lift your shoulder, tuck your front leg tight to your body, and then put your hoof closer towards your body. So in my own body, I can feel. Take your shoulders and just pull them up just a second. Tighten them up a little bit. And then pretend your hands are hooked and just pull them into you. Just tighten them up. Now, physically, now relax. Physically, that's what I felt in my body. In my mind, I'm Toby looking at the rail, jumping over. So I'm using my whole body to communicate with the animals. So I give the vision, tuck it up close, stretch out the back leg, and tuck that back leg in just a little bit more, and then jump over. That's all I did. I gave him the information that he just needed to tighten the body up a little bit. Now, when I experienced jumping over the rail, I also felt that he just wasn't thinking this was very important. And you know, horses don't know anything about a job, making money, that the better that they do in the ring, that they can make money doing that. So what I did was I gave him pictures of jumping over each rail, finishing, and then at the end, he would be getting more and more hay and oats. I related it to that so that he could know that Mark and him have the sameness. He'd get oats, Mark would get this green paper. He'd get oats and hay, Mark would get this green paper. So, now, how did I change that horse? How many of you saw that other horse, the dark horse with the beautiful body? Isn't he gorgeous? Now, his parents, his whole history, his parents and his grandparents, they were foxtrotters. And when Diamond was a little colt, he was sold. And he was trained Western. And he was the champion barrel racer with lots of ribbons, lots of trophies. Now, how many know about barrel racing? How many of you know about barrel racing? Great, so there's a lot of horse people here. Okay, so you know that when they go around that barrel, they've got to go fairly close, and they have some figures that they have to do. So what I did is I sat there and I asked him, could you show me your excellence? Could you show me what you've already learned? So he took that whole arena, went all the way to the end, and then ran towards me, pretended he went around the barrels, and then came up, and as I'm watching him move, I'm going, oh my gosh, is he gorgeous. Look at his form. You know how it feels when, especially you guys, you know how it feels when you get a star or a paper or you do really, really good on your report card and you go home and you show your parents and they're really proud of you? Well, when Diamond was sold, the man no longer paid attention to the ribbons that he got. And because knowledge, his excellence, he felt pretty bad. And he didn't understand. It's a different language. Foxtrotting is a different language than moving Western. So they spent one whole year trying to get him to understand me, and he couldn't get it. So they hear about me. I went to the stable, and I asked him to move, and then I could see how beautiful he was. I acknowledged, told him for what excellence he had already achieved, and then I said to him, your whole history, your parents, your grandparents, were foxtrotters. This is all you need to do. Now, foxtrotting means that the front legs move at a different speed than the back legs. Meaning, the front goes up like this. The back has long, slow strides in the back. The front is really quick. So, in my mind, I say, what does it feel like to be a new diamond? Foxtrot. The front legs moving at a faster rate, very high, than the back legs. And that's all I did. And he immediately changed and started doing the movement. Because I gave him the information what he needed, and how I gave that to him is to picture him doing it in my mind. How many of you can picture your animals doing something? How many of you picture you doing things? Wow, do you know that an Olympic team or runners or any athlete, their coaches always tell them, fantasize, picture yourself going and hitting that ribbon and winning. When this year, actually it was about two years ago, I was asked by Michael Crichton, who wrote Jurassic Park, he flew me to Germany to work with his Icelandic course. His Icelandic course was going to be in the World Championship Icelandic horse show. And so he flew me to Germany to work with the course on the U.S. team. So when I was there, I had to talk to each of the horses, find out if they were in good shape, if there was any kind of problem, and give them pictures on what to do. Just be the animal, see exactly what he did. Now his horse that he had hurt a leg, so that horse couldn't participate. So poor Anne Marie has got to do it, work on another horse, ride another horse that she had never ridden before. And this horse was a male, and he was very, very sturdy. So every single time that she tried to get into the saddle, she put her foot in it, the stirrup, and started to, that horse would step back. And if you have a horse step back when you're trying to get into the saddle, it's not very good because you could get hurt. So I had to close my eyes and then let myself ask him, why are you doing this? Now, how I ask the question is by seeing him. Now, his solution to his problem is the action he's taking. You take the solution away, you get to see why they do it. Meaning, if in my mind I see Anne Marie getting on the horse without stepping back, that's how I ask the question. So, I give a vision of her getting on and he can't step back. Pretty soon, he gets a little bit nervous and I use my body as a way to pick up the information. I get pictures in my mind, I get feelings in my body, I get even sensations. The sensation I got was as she put the weight on the stirrup, it felt like it was getting pinched. So his solution was if I step back, I stretch my skin, I can't get pinched. And I'm like, whoa! So you get pinched every time she gets in the saddle. Well, we will put an extra flap, we'll put our hand there, smooth it out, make sure that when she goes to get on, or anybody goes to climb onto you, you won't get pinched. You could just stretch out your back leg just a little bit more, stand firm. That's what he did. That's all he needs to hear. I want to tell you about a special event that I had. When I was a little girl, I had a lot of trouble with reading and writing, but I was really good at fantasizing, and I was really good at painting and drawing. And I had two big prayers. My first prayer, because I didn't feel capable, was, God, please give me a brain that works. And the other one was, make me old enough to get out of here. And so that magic number was 35. I had in my mind that someday I'll be grown up, and grown up meant 35. Well, when I finally reached 35, I went to the beach with my kids to go surfing. I had four kids. And when I got to the beach, I was thinking, oh, it's so gorgeous, and I'm finally 35. So the kids went into the water, and I'm just happy that I finally made it. I finally am 35. And all of a sudden, I noticed a harbor seal coming out of the water. And I noticed some little kids throwing rocks at the harbor seal. And so what I did was I got my body up and moved a little bit closer and then sat down. And then I do this thing when I want a wild animal to come to visit me, and I want that being to know I'm a safe place. You can talk to me. You can hang out with me. So what I did is I think about a sunset. As if, you know how you can be sad if you look at a sunset, it makes you quiet in your mind, quiet in your emotions. It just quiets you. So I'm thinking about this sun being in the middle of the sunset, and the sunset's all around me. All of a sudden, this harbor seal starts coming closer and closer and closer and closer. And next thing I know, he climbs up on my lap, and they have little harbor seals have teeny tiny ears. They have little bugged out eyes. They look like puppies. And they have this little bit of amber fur. When the sun dried the fur, it's amber colored. And here he is sitting on my lap, his head here, his little back fin here. And I know that if he comes out of the water, it means he doesn't feel really good. So I just put my hands on either part of his stomach, and I'm thinking really good thoughts, thinking, boy, I hope he starts feeling better. And I'm so happy because it's my birthday, and it feels like an incredible birthday gift to me. So I'm sitting there all day. The kids come out of the water, and they're wanting to eat lunch, and they're used to mom being something strange anyway. They come out, and, oh, that's cute, Mom. I need a sandwich. And I'd tell them where it is, and I'd stay right where I was. I didn't want to move. I didn't want this harbor seal off my lap. All day long, I'm sitting there. Then all of a sudden, people would come up, because it's not normal to see a harbor seal sitting on somebody's lap. And they want to get close and take a good look. And every single time someone would come up and look at it, he'd lift his head up. He'd start growling at him, and I would have to go, whoa, he's my personal friend, and he doesn't like strangers. Could you just back up, please? And the people would back up, and he would just lay his head back down, go to sleep. All day long, I did that, with my legs straight out, and this little harbor seal on me. Pretty soon, the sun started to set. And the kids come over and say to me, Mom, come on, we're hungry, and we have a birthday cake for you, and we have presents, and you can't stay here all night. You can't take it with you, and you can't stay here. Come on, Mom. Try to get up, and I was like, so sad that I had to leave him. And I just said a little prayer and I thought, you know, he's going to be okay. So the next day, I got up very early and I drove over and I was hoping that the harbor seal would be there, but it wasn't. I knew that his family came by and his herd came by and he was able to find them. For just that little bit of time, even though I looked strange to him, he didn't care that I was that safe environment to stay with me just for a little while. So if you want to have a while, me come up and spend time with you, you have to be kind of quiet inside and kind of have a feeling like it would be safe to get to know me. It would be safe. I would like to spend time with you. In nature, I've had many, many people walk up to me. My great desire is to have the birds come and fly on me. Some days that'll happen. They'll come close, but I just don't have them come and fly right on my shoulder. And I'd like that to happen. I had squirrels come up to me. I had squirrels taking stuff out of my hands, wanting to climb on me and touch me. But I want the birds. You know, is there any problems that you have? Because I would really like to tell you how you can. Your name is? I know. Oh, yes, Sharon. Yeah. And you know what? I think we just talked to your mom a little while ago because she gave us directions. And she said, you'll see my son with the orange hair. I like your hair. A lot. It looks great. Yes. Now, what kind of problems do you have? And then we'll talk about how you can give a vision back. Yes. How you can get your dog to stop eating the chicken. Whoa, this is a biggie. We start off with a huge problem, not a little one. Start off with a huge problem. First off, I would give him the job of protecting the chickens. I would see him patrolling them and making sure no foxes and no raccoons get close. And the more that you see him patrolling the cage, patrolling around and watching them, I give him a feeling of how much you appreciate that. That's where I would start with him. How many of you have dogs? How many of you have dogs that bark? And how many of you can actually hear your dog barking in your mind? Recall the sound of the dog barking. It's really easy to hear barking either. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you how to help a barking dog. Because you know, many people have it. I'll get to you next. I'll answer the question next. Many people have a dog that don't know how much to bark. And I had this yesterday. We went to Phoenix Elementary School, and I had a little girl come up to me, and the little girl said to me, you know what? My dog already had to go to court. And I'm really, really sad because I don't know what to do or what to say to my little dog. And because my dog barks all the time, they're going to take my dog away if it doesn't stop. And if they take it away, that means it's going to go to the Humane Society. So this is why it's so important to learn how to communicate with animals. This way, when she goes home, yesterday when she went home, she got to talk to her dog and tell her dog, this is what I need you to do. I'll continue to do it. Now, this is what I told her. Pretend first that you are your dog. So I want you to pretend you're your dog. And I want you to pretend in your mind that you're barking three barks, then stop. Can you Can you hear the 3 marks?
Yeah.
All right, now, this is the part that's missing. This is the part that they need. And if they get this part, then it means that they won't go to the pound or the Humane Society or some sanctuary. So, I want you to be very, very quiet for a moment. You get really, really quiet. Now, animals can hear spherically, meaning they are really good at hearing all the information on the other side of this wall, on the other side of that wall, on the other side of that wall, and on the other side of that wall, all at one time. Now, I want you to try to do this, because as you try to use your ability to hear spherically, you're telling them, use your ears. We need you to listen. Now let's do it. And see how much information you can hear. Close your eyes a minute and just listen. That would have been a shock.